people.
Live from our nation's capital, it's Deadline DC with Brad Bannon.
Welcome to Deadline DC with Brad Bannon. I'm Brad Bannon because no one else would take the job. My company, Bannon Communication Research, polls for progressive issue groups, labor unions, and Democrats. Mondays on Deadline DC, I talk to the people and players behind the politics and policies that drive our great nation forward. We've got a really big show for you today. In the first half hour, our guest is Mica Soellner, excuse my Boston accent there, who is a congressional reporter for the Washington Times. In the second half hour, our guest is Kimberly Clark, who is the publisher of DemList. And behind the scenes today, we have our good friend and intrepid executive producer, Mark Grimaldi, who keeps the trains running on time and the show running online. We're going to start off the show today with a clip from Representative Marjorie Taylor Greene, telling us that the abort of the Capitol coup on January 6th would have been a lot worse if she had been in charge.
I come to Washington, I swear in on January 3rd, I get accused of giving insurrection tours, which I thought was hilarious because I couldn't even find the bathroom in the Capitol. True story. Then January 6th happens, and next thing you know, I organize the whole thing along with Steve Bannon here.
That was
so that if Steve Bannon and I had organized that, we would have won.
Representative
Taylor
Greene talking about. I'm stepping over the clip again, aren't I? Okay. Okay, that was Marjorie Taylor Greene talking about how things would have been different if she had been running the Capitol coup. Later, she said her statement about bringing guns to the Capitol coup was sarcasm. And by the way, her comrade in arms, Stephen Bannon, is the black sheep of my family. That was sarcasm. Okay, anyway, let's roll with the show. Our guest in this half hour is Mica Soellner, who is the congressional reporter for the Washington Times. Mica, welcome back to Deadline DC with Brad Bannon. Thanks for coming again.
Thanks for having me on, Brad.
Okay, well, I heard this clip from Representative Marjorie Taylor Greene, and my first thought, after being completely shocked, and I shouldn't be anymore after all this, is how is Kevin McCarthy, the heir apparent Speaker of the House of Representatives, going to manage Marjorie Taylor Greene and the rest of the Freedom Caucus?
Yeah, well, that's a great question. So, I mean, we are seeing, you know, Marjorie Taylor Greene has really stepped away a little bit from some of the comments that she's made in the past. Kevin McCarthy is going to have to be receptive to her because she right now is supporting him, you know, which, you know, a lot of people thought wouldn't be the case, given some of her history and some of her ties to a little bit more of the right of the party. You know, I mean, you see things like the clip that you just showed, and it shows that, you know, he's probably going to have to walk a fine line there between condemning some of the things that she says and does and others in the conference, but also being able to unify the party, which is a big concern right now, as we're seeing, you know, at least five Republicans, you know, allege their independence from McCarthy and swear not to support him as speaker. And so that poses a huge challenge for him in a narrow majority.
Okay, let me ask you this question. There's been a lot of talk and comment about the battle that Kevin McCarthy faces becoming speaker, because there are several prominent, very conservative members of the Republican House caucus who are pointedly not supporting his bid. So my question to you is Kevin McCarthy's election as speaker a done deal, or is there going to be a lot of drama behind it, or both?
I think we can definitely expect to see a lot of drama happening in the next month or so. It doesn't look like McCarthy has the 218 votes needed to secure the speakership. I know that he's working hard to rally members against him, and he's got some good support from, leaders within the GOP conference. We just mentioned Marjorie Taylor Greene, but he's also got Jim Jordan, who is floated by some of his defectors as being a potential alternative to him. He's got Steve Scalise on his side. So the people that would be able to challenge him, really aren't rising up. So we're really only seeing five, more conservative members in this kind of Never Kevin anti-McCarthy group. But there are some people in circles of, some of the more right-wing members saying that, there's no way that McCarthy is going to be able to be speaker given his math problem at the moment. So I think we're going to see, and I know that he's willing to go and have multiple votes to hopefully get people to change their mind.
Okay. I heard one comment which I sort of chuckled at. Maybe I shouldn't, but I laugh at a lot of things I probably shouldn't. I heard that Democrats might try to reach out to the moderates in the GOP House caucus. And I thought to myself, are there any moderates in the GOP House caucus? And do they have any power to rein in the Jim Jordans and Marjorie Taylor Greens of the world? First of all, do they exist or are they extinct?
We're definitely seeing, and we saw Fred Upton, for example, floated as a potential alternative to Kevin McCarthy, which, is highly unlikely. He was one of the 10 who voted to impeach former President Donald Trump back in January, over January 6th. Last year. And, there's definitely a few moderates in the Republican Party. I don't think any of them would switch over and vote for a Democrat and commit political suicide like that. But I do think that, there's a lot of probably behind the scenes outreach that could be happening, that they might not say. But I think that, I don't think that's a very broad possibility, but it's definitely one that Republicans are saying, in hopes of saying, if you can't get behind McCarthy, there's no alternative, and then you're ultimately giving Democrats power.
Okay, let's try this. Assuming that Kevin McCarthy does become speaker, what are we going to see as the priorities of the GOP House caucus when they take over in January? Are we going to be hearing mostly about, the other day, Marjorie Taylor Greene called again for impeachment of President Biden because of the prisoner swap with the Russians. Jim Jordan, I think, is going to be chair of the Judiciary Committee. Is that true?
That's right. We're going to be seeing a lot of investigations on behalf of the Republican conference, and they've laid out their plans already. Jordan, like you said, will be in charge of Judiciary, so that obviously has jurisdiction over any impeachment efforts that Republicans might make. Now, McCarthy has gone back and forth on whether he wants to pursue those. And that's been one of the grievances of the five hard right Republicans that have taken issue with him. We're also going to see investigations into Hunter Biden. His ties to U.S. adversaries and how that impacts the White House, as well as COVID and Dr. Fauci, some of the main concerns that Republicans have raised in recent years.
Okay. One more question before we go to a break for our radio listeners. Are we going to see any impeachment moves, or is that just people in a caucus blowing off steam?
There's definitely people within the conference that really wants to move aggressively on impeachment. And I think the most likely target would be Secretary Mayorkas over the border. I know the border has been a huge issue that Republicans have been talking about and used as a midterm issue, especially in, you know, more neighboring states, the southern border. So if anyone, I know that they're really aggressively going after him. And that's one, you know, administration official that McCarthy has kind of, you know, weighed in on a little bit. And I know Jordan's weighed in on him. And then Andy Biggs has been really aggressively trying to lobby people that this is, you know, that needs to be done. And I actually had a conversation with him a couple of weeks ago where he said he thinks that Republicans having the power for 2 years and not going after Mayorkas and impeaching him would be a waste.
Okay, we're going to take a very short break for our radio listeners. If you're watching us on Twitter, Facebook, or YouTube, don't go anywhere because we will be continuing. But for radio listeners, just hang on, and we'll be back with you in a couple of minutes with more of Deadline DC with Brad Bannon.
I want to get back to seeing my grandbabies every Sunday.
Welcome back to Deadline DC with Brad Bannon. My guest in this half hour is Mica Soellner, who is a congressional reporter for the Washington Times. I'm going to switch topics now. One of the big news items last week, and I know I read the piece you wrote about it, was Kristen Sinema, the senator from Arizona, announced that she was changing her party registration from Democratic to independent. What kind of impact is this going to have on the Senate side?
Yeah, so I definitely think that, you know, anyone who's been kind of following Senator Sinema's career in recent years knows that this really came as no surprise for her to exit the Democratic Party. That said, it's not expected to change any kind of power structure in the upper chamber. You know, Sinema's always voted independently. And of course, the other two independents in the Senate, Bernie Sanders and Angus King, both caucus with Democrats. You know, they have the 51-49 majority after Georgia. So, you know, it shouldn't be a huge problem for Democrats in the time being in Congress. But I think the question is how it might impact the party in 2024 when she is up for reelection. Now, she hasn't decided that she's going to run again, but that's going to be a different area altogether.
Now, she is facing, she was facing possibly Democratic primary opposition from one of the Democratic U.S. Representatives. And I saw one poll in Arizona that showed she was getting clobbered in a Democratic primary, which may have something to do with her re-registering as running as an independent if she does run. What do you think her prospects would be if there was first of all, how would Republicans treat this race if there was a Democratic candidate? I think Representative Gallego, she was running as an independent. What would the Republicans do?
So I think that's the big question. And Republicans will definitely try and take back the seat, especially if there's a three-way primary between a Democrat, Republican, and independent, being Sinema. So I think it really depends whether they decide to run someone who's more far on the right. That might backfire and bring more centrist and more independent, maybe more moderate voters to, you know, go for Sinema, who's an independent, rather than now that there's an alternative option just to voting for the Democrat. If they do propose a more moderate GOP candidate, then that might put some trouble for Sinema, because it obviously seems like, you know, the voters in Arizona are a little bit more ideologically diverse than other states. So I think that, you know, it's really going to depend what kind of candidate runs against her. But she would have definitely had a tough time in the primary, like you mentioned, against Ruben Gallego, who was obviously vying for a likely Senate challenge. And then there's others been floated too that would, you know, potentially have been, you know, other primary challengers. So that'll be its own battle, and we'll see what she decides to do.
Okay, we are going to take another short break, but bring back our radio listeners. So we'll be back with more Deadline DC with Brad Bannon and our guest Mica Soellner from the Washington Times. Okay. Welcome back to Deadline DC with Brad Bannon. Our guest in this half hour is Mica Soellner, who is congressional correspondent for the Washington Times. Welcome back to our radio listeners. If you would like to watch us as well as listen to us, you can watch us at twitter.com/Brad Bannon or on facebook.com/DeadlineDC with Brad Bannon /videos. Okay, we're talking to Mica Soellner from the Washington Times. I want to turn to Donald Trump. The other big news from last week, there was a lot of big news last week, was Raphael Warnock won the runoff election in Georgia over his Republican opponent, Herschel Walker. Why do Republicans think they lost that race?
Well, a lot of Republicans are crediting it to, you know, thinking that maybe Herschel Walker wasn't the strongest candidate to pick against Warnock, who seems to be kind of on the rise for Democrats. You know, there are a few controversies surrounding Walker, you know, with the abortion issue, as well as some other comments that he had made. His ties to Donald Trump probably like didn't help, given the kind of record that the former president has had in the midterms with the candidates that he's endorsed. So I think that there are a lot of factors that kind of, you know, made the race a little bit more successful for Warnock. And so I think we're seeing that, especially given kind of his, you know, previous time in the Senate too. He's been able to, I think he's been up 4 times for re-election since he's been in, which hasn't been very long, and he's been able to, you know, win all of them.
Okay. In reaction to Warnock's victory and Walker's defeat, several, at least a few GOP senators came to the conclusion and said openly they thought Donald Trump was responsible for Walker's defeat. I think you're right. I think it's more complicated than that, but I think Trump's did play a role in Walker's defeat. Mitt Romney, for example, came out, who's not surprising, he's always been antagonistic towards Donald Trump, said that Trump is a big problem for the GOP. And Romney said, when as far as to say that he would not vote for Trump in 2024 if he was the GOP nominee. Seems to me a few other Republican senators made kind of snide comments about Trump. There seems to be a big division between GOP elites and how they feel about Trump and GOP rank and file. If you look at Trump's support among rank and file Republican primary voters, it still seems to be pretty strong. But there seem to be a lot of Republicans, especially in the Senate, including Mitch McConnell, who are very critical. How is this, you know, how is this going to play out, do you think, in terms of 2024?
Yeah, that's the key question there is, I think, you know, we're going to see a lot of Trump fatigue from, you know, a lot of the members, especially after the midterm results and how unsuccessful a lot of his endorsements were. That said, Trump still has a lot of support from his key base. But, you know, there's been other issues where he's going after other successful Republicans like Ron DeSantis in Florida and then Glenn Youngkin in Virginia. And that might be something that turns off his base and might, you know, kind of ebb away at some of his supporters there, too. So I think it's just a matter of how he kind of can handle himself in the next 2 years or so, but also just, you know, who gets into the ring, who could potentially primary him. So I personally don't necessarily think it could be in the bag for Trump, kind of given the climate and the atmosphere and just kind of this like post era. And you mentioned Mitt Romney's comments. Again, I agree with you, not surprising, but we also saw people come out after the midterms, someone like Virginia Lieutenant Governor Winston Sears, who, you know, is a very conservative woman. She's not an anti-Trump, you know, person by any means, but she also said that she thinks that it's time to move on. So I think that was very telling as well.
Okay. Well, let me ask you the question in a more general way. Why do Republicans in Washington think they did not do as well? There was certainly no red wave as most Republicans, and I think a lot of Democrats, expected. Why do Republicans think they fell short of their goals? Is it, you know, they blame Trump? Or there, you know, something about the campaigns they run or whatever?
Yeah, I think there was definitely some blame to Trump, and just that, you know, maybe the party has moved a little bit more to the right and people are a little bit exhausted about, you know, some of the things tied to the former president. The other aspect was abortion was definitely a higher issue. And that's something that I've heard from, you know, Republicans as well, saying that that was an issue that definitely knocked some people out. I talked to Ohio Representative Steve Chabot, who obviously lost his lost his seat after serving, I think, for almost 20 years in Congress. And he said, you know, abortion definitely played a huge role in his race and his defeat. And, you know, I think that was an issue that Republicans maybe tried to back away from. We saw them, you know, not trying to use that as much, but Democrats really hammered it in that they were extreme on that issue. But also just the fact that this is a year that Roe versus Wade was overturned was huge. And I think it made a huge impact in the midterms.
The short answer is it did have a big impact. In fact, if you look at the National Election Day poll, almost as many people said they voted because of their position on abortion as did who said they were concerned about inflation. And so I guess my question to you is how does the GOP back away from what is, you know, it seems to me a fundamental part of the reason for support from the Republican base? Can they do that?
Well, I think that puts them in a really tough position for them to back away. I think that, you know, introducing legislation like, you know, Lindsey Graham trying to impose a 6-week abortion ban, that's not going to be popular with a lot of people who are a little bit more moderate on that issue and just in general. We also saw a really strong youth vote turnout, which I don't think I mentioned before, but, you know, they tend to be a little bit more progressive and to the left of even the Democratic Party. So, and they're becoming increasingly active in politics. So that's not going to win any younger voters as well. So I think it's very hard for Republicans to try and break away from some of their cultural norms, because that's what their electorate wants. And a lot of the electorate, that's an issue by issue vote. So, you know, if someone is anti-abortion, then they're not going to, you know, they're going to carry that with them when they vote.
Okay. How difficult a time do you think Donald Trump will have winning the GOP presidential nomination in 2024? I mean, is Ron DeSantis a serious threat to Trump?
I think Trump views Ron DeSantis as a threat, and that's, you know, why some of the reasons why he might be going after him. You know, there's a lot of people that kind of speculate that, you know, DeSantis could actually beat Trump. But I think it's a matter of whether he decides to run. And, you know, it's going to take a lot to go up after Trump, who still, like I said, remains very popular in a lot of his base. And, you know, is willing to go after anyone that challenges him as well.
Okay. Okay. I want to thank Mica Soellner, who's congressional correspondent for The Washington Times, for joining us today. We still have another half hour of Deadline DC with Brad Bannon to go. Our guest in the second half hour will be Kimberly Scott, the publisher of DemList. We'll be right back with more of Deadline DC right after these messages. Victory in Georgia was the capstone of a Democratic midterm performance in the face of heavy odds that surpassed anybody's expectations. Now the real fun begins, and we'll find out whether Democrats can extend the party's good fortune through 2024. That is from my most recent Hill column. If you'd like to read all of my Hill columns, or just the last three that I've all written that are mainly about Donald Trump and the black cloud that he carries over the Republican Party, You can read them all at muckrack.com. That's muckrack.com/Brad Bannon/articles. Before we bring on our guest, we're going to play this clip that is from the chairman of the Democratic National Party, Jamie Harrison.
I'm grateful that President Biden and the Rules and Bylaws Committee of the DNC moved up South Carolina. I'm really looking forward to this amazing calendar as a whole. It starts with three small states, South Carolina, Nevada, where you have a strong Latino and labor voices there, New Hampshire, where they believe in small government. Those three states will kick it off. And then you move to some of our larger states, Michigan and Georgia, two of our big battleground states that will also be a part of that window, where we see the New South rising in Georgia, and we see the heart of the middle class that was born in Michigan, in Detroit. So this is a fantastic, fantastic window of states that the president has recommended. And we will move forward on, and we'll have our official vote on this in February. But when you think about it, we shouldn't be surprised by Joe Biden putting these states up forward, because this is a president that has understood the power of making sure all of us have our voices be heard and have a seat at the table. You look at what he has done in terms of his cabinet, most diverse cabinet ever, the judiciary, where half of his appointments have women, women of color, including the first black woman on the Supreme Court. So this is just yet another thing that we see with the visionary leadership of Joe Biden, making sure that all boats rise in this America.
That is was Jamie Harrison, the chair of the Democratic National Committee, who, by the way, is from South Carolina, which under the DNC proposal will lead the parade that ends up in the White House in 2024. Our guest in this half hour is Kimberly Scott. She is the publisher of DemList. DemList is a great go-to guide for following the inner workings of the Democratic Party. And that's why we asked Kim here to discuss the DNC rule changes. DemList is the go-to place for knowledge about Democratic policies and politics and policies. Kim, welcome back to Deadline DC with Brad Bannon. Great to have you on. I see you got Christmas decorations on.
Yes, of course.
Good.
All in this.
Okay, let's start. One of the big news items last week, and I'm always in favor of big news items because it gives us stuff to talk about on Deadline DC, was the Democratic National Committee's decision to rearrange the nomination schedule leading up to the 2024 presidential election. First of all, why don't you tell our viewers and listeners what the Democratic National Committee did?
Well, under current DNC rules, no state can hold a primary before the first Tuesday in March. That has traditionally been Iowa, New Hampshire, Nevada, and South Carolina. In April, the DNC decided they were going to exercise or implement a new review process that prioritizes battleground states and also diversity, ethnic, geographic, union representation in the states. This, of course, upended Iowa's coveted first-in-the-nation caucus status, which it's held for five decades. But there's reasons for this. Iowa is 89% white. It has 6.5 union membership. It awarded Trump an 8-point victory in 2020. And that was also amidst a terrible technical tabulation debacle.
Oh, I remember that. That was horrible.
They'll never live that down.
We didn't find out who won the caucus until
many days
later on.
But it's also one of the last caucuses, So primaries are elections that are actually run by state and local governments. A caucus is a meeting, essentially. It's a very antiquated way of doing things. It disadvantages working people who can't be there on that one night, handicapped people, and it's a private, I mean, a public forum for debate, and that it's positive. But, you know, last presidential cycle, caucuses, like 12 additional states went from caucuses to primary. It's basically Iowa, Wyoming, and three territories that are left. And so this is something that people have been advocating for a long time to dispense with the caucuses and have all states run by a primary, and something that was advocated by Biden himself, which pretty much put the nail in the coffin for Iowa.
Okay, let me ask you this. The folks in New Hampshire especially were very upset. I've seen both Democratic U.S. senators on TV talking about the rule change, and they're hopping mad. The New Hampshire argument, I guess, is that it's a small state. It allows for a relatively unknown candidate have a chance at, building up some momentum through the nomination process. First of all, I believe it is New Hampshire state law that they have the first presidential primary in the nation. And unless they change the law, there's going to be big trouble. And what is the penalty for New Hampshire and Iowa just for ignoring the DNC?
Well, the DNC also increased the penalty power of states that go ahead in line of the established early primary window, and that they can automatically lose half their delegates. The same is for candidates that campaign in unsanctioned states. They also have penalties. So that might be lack of access to data, lack of access to debates.
Okay. We're going to take a short break here, Kim, so we can let our radio listeners have a small break, but we'll be staying on video. Our guest is Kimberly Scott, the publisher of DemList, and this is Deadline DC with Brad Bannon. So don't go anywhere. We'll be back with our radio listeners in a couple of minutes, and we're hanging on with our video viewers.
What I know about courage, I learned from my adoptive mom. She said sometimes you just...
Welcome back to Deadline DC with Brad Bannon. Our guest in this half hour is Kimberly Scott, the publisher of DemList, which is your go-to website for all news about Democratic politics and policies. And for that reason, we brought Kim here to talk about the new DNC rules changes, which will drastically change the campaign schedule. Let me give you a for instance here. I'm going to date myself, but our viewers, know that for my gray hair, I've been around for a while. Radio listeners would just have to trust me when they come back. I remember Jimmy Carter in 1976. And he, started campaigning in Iowa a year early, I think. Famously stayed in people's, slept on people's couches in Des Moines, Davenport, and other locations, and managed to build up a head of steam to win the Iowa caucuses that year, which of course launched him onto the presidency. And I've heard some people make the argument that by eliminating the caucuses, that basically ruling out the possibility some maverick candidate like Jimmy Carter can come out of the blue without a whole lot of money, without much money to spend on television, and just win it for out of pure organizational guts. How do you answer that argument, Kim?
Well, I understand it. I think Pete Buttigieg was an example of that before as well. And it's a small state But again, it's just the, you know, fundamentally this disadvantages voters. It goes against what the premise of what elections are supposed to be, and that is everybody has the right and the opportunity to vote, which you can do with an election, you cannot do with a caucus. You know, it's, I think there's important that you do have the representation of small states. There were some people who have problems with Michigan being added to the new calendar because it's large. There's going to have to be a lot of money spent on television. But it all comes down to the same thing, get out the vote.
Okay, some people, at least a few people I've heard said that the reason the DNC made this change in bumping Iowa out and bringing out up South Carolina was to South Carolina was the first state that Joe Biden won during the 2020 primaries. He did very well there. And, it, you know, in fact, going into South Carolina, a lot of after, you know, not so stellar performances in Iowa and New Hampshire, a lot of people thought that Joe Biden's candidacy was in big trouble, but South Carolina rescued him. And some people are saying, well, this was where Joe Biden's way of ramping up his reelection campaign for 2024. Do you think that's true?
I do. I don't, obviously not an accident, but I mean, there is a valid case for South Carolina. The Democratic primarily is heavily African-American in turnout. But they did deliver the nomination to Biden in 2020. And by ensuring that South Carolina goes first, he's not taking any chances.
Okay, you know? We're going to have to interrupt you again, Kim. Sorry, because we have to bring back our radio listeners. But we'll have more of Deadline DC with Kim Scott, the publisher of DemList, right after we bring back the radio listeners after this very short break. Welcome back to Deadline DC with Brad Bannon. We're talking presidential politics, which I guess we'll be doing a lot in the next 2 years. Our guest in this half hour is Kimberly Scott, the publisher of DemList, which is the go-to site for news about the Democratic Party, politics, and policy. What's the website for DemList, by the way, Kim?
www.demlist.com, and you can sign up there to get my daily column, which is followed nationally in every state in 50 countries. And it's a private list. It's not sold.
Okay, great. I encourage, I read Deadline DC every day, so, and I suggest you all do too. Okay, back to presidential politics here. One of the best arguments that I've heard for South Carolina is that now that it's going to be at the head of the pack, it gives African-American voters a bigger voice in the primary process. And there's good reason for doing that. If you look at the exit polls from the 2022 midterms or the 2020 presidential candidate campaign or going back, African-American voters always are the biggest single supporter of Democratic candidates for president, governor, House, Senate, and everything else, probably. So this is an opportunity to recognize African-American voters, isn't it?
Yes, so they are essentially the backbone of the party. And it's something Biden advocated for, as she said, the, you know, giving voters of color a more prominent place in this process and in the party. Going back to South Carolina again, I think that with South Carolina up front, then I don't think there's any question that Joe Biden at least believes that he is running for re-election.
Okay. One last thing about this before we move on. Do you think there's going to be a lot of drama about this change, or is it everybody going to, you know, including Iowa and New Hampshire, going to accept it?
No, there will definitely be drama, but it is politics.
Yeah, it is.
They have.
What would politics be without drama?
But there's also a chance that their state laws, as we discussed earlier, like New Hampshire, I mean, may prevent that. There are challenges ahead, regardless of the politics themselves. So New Hampshire has a state law, I mean, state in its constitution that they are the first primary in the country. So they have to get back through that.
Way around that, by the way, is for New Hampshire. I don't know if the DNC would go for this, but for one way around this is for New Hampshire to run a beauty contest in the presidential race without awarding delegates based on the vote. Would that be permissible under the new DNC regs?
I don't see how that is based on what you're saying. And saying basically, jump the line and hold their own.
Yeah, it would be a beauty contest with no delegates awarded.
Yeah, no, it's still, delegates are still a part of the process.
Okay, so much for that idea. Sorry, New Hampshire.
There'll be challenges. They have till January 5th to certify that they can be, that they can take their place in line as it is, which, by the way, is first South Carolina, February 3rd, the New Hampshire and Nevada on February 6th, Georgia February 13th, and then Michigan on February 27th. Okay. And there's each state has a case. Minnesota's one that was close. Essentially, Michigan took that place. But Georgia and Michigan delivered. They flipped the states in the last presidential. All of these criteria have been carefully considered.
Okay. Now is probably a good time to change subjects. We have big changes in politics as a result of the 2022 midterms. We're probably going to have a Republican speaker, I guess, although the Republicans have to get their act straightened out before they can claim the throne. We do have new Democratic leadership in the House. Nancy Pelosi will continue as a member of Congress, but she will not be the Democratic leader. We have a whole new, fresh, younger legislative slate. Let's start with the new Democratic leader, Mr. Jeffries. Tell us about him.
So, as we know, Pelosi actually cut this deal 2 terms ago, that she would be leaving the leadership, if not Congress, at the end of this year. And so Hakeem Jeffries has been, who was the House Democratic Caucus Chair for the last 4 years, he's been groomed for this. It's difficult to see her go. I mean, there are few, if any, technical or legislative tacticians on her level in Congress. But they've been preparing for this transition, and it is a dramatic one. I mean, Pelosi, Steny Hoyer, who stepped down, they're in their 80s. Clyburn, who is still staying in leadership, but is taking a lesser position as an assistant leader. But Jeffries won this unanimously by his caucus and has the full support of his caucus. Then the others, Catherine Clark,
Well, let me ask you a question about Jeffries first before we go on to the rest of the team. One of the remarkable things about Jeffries, besides the fact that he comes from Brooklyn in New York City, is that he will be, I think, the first African-American party leader in the House of Representatives.
Yes, he will be the first one. And a number of these are first as well. Jeffries is the first African-American. He's only 52 years old. Catherine Clark, the number two, has been in her, just the first previously as assistant leader in this position. Pete Aguilera is now the highest ranking Hispanic to have been appointed. He's in the number three position. It is the diverse face of representation of America that Biden has been looking for. But it is a united caucus, unlike the Republicans.
Oh, what a mess.
Well, there's no alternative to Kevin McCarthy. And so if there was, we might all have hope, but under any circumstances, it's going to be very difficult for him to legislate.
How much of a margin do they have? What, four seats now? Or
it's 213 Democrats, 222 Republicans. And so, you know, which is basically essentially what the Democrats had. And so it's going to be very difficult for him to push forward, you know, items on their agenda when the votes are that close. And he's also said he is the only one running for this position, but he has got huge factions of the Republican Party that are against him. You know, Freedom Caucus members, there are some that adamantly refuse to vote for him. And so I think he'll eventually get it, but it'll take a few rounds of votes to get to the 218 that they need to secure the speakership.
Yeah. Any chance of Donald Trump becoming speaker? Just kidding. For Marjorie Taylor Greene, that's sarcasm, by the way. Let me ask you this question. Just sort of curious, and we only have a minute. Why Hakeem Jeffries? Why did he, you know, claim the Game of Thrones?
He's earned it. I said he's
how?
He's widely respected. He has been working in leadership already, he said, for 4 years. He has the full support of the outgoing team.
Okay. And what do you think, is he going to be, how will he be different as a party leader than Nancy Pelosi? Any ideas?
I think that he's laying out an agenda that is a long-term one. You know, he's gotten some of the experience and maturity to do this. He's coming off of, you know, a cycle that was doing very well for Democrats, and I think that's important to take the message forward. I think that in the end, democracy prevailed when people thought democracy was under threat. It was one of the largest issues going into the election. And I think that this is, you know, it's a huge win for Democrats, but it's also a huge win for Americans. And, you know, I think the lessons or the things to watch is how the Republicans move forward. You know, they lost at the hands of Donald Trump, who handpicked many of these candidates, failed miserably. And the lesson they still have yet to learn is it's time.
Jim, I'm sorry. That's all the time we have on today's edition of Deadline DC. We hope to see you again after the first of the year. Thanks to our guest, the Washington Times, Kimberly Scott, the publisher of DemList, and our intrepid executive producer, Mark Grimaldi. We'll be talking to you again next Monday.
Happy holidays.
Happy holidays.